straight. It hurts to let go, but it hurts more to stay. I'm moving on. I'm moving on. Hey, I'm moving on. Hey, hey. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I bring you greetings tonight with the love of Jesus from In Season Ministries, where our pastors are the anointed man and woman of God, Pastor Chips and Pastor Bridgette Davis. Can we give God a hand for the shepherds of this house? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We thank God for our leaders. Hallelujah. We are located at 1801 Port Malabar Boulevard in the beautiful city of Palm Bay, Florida. Hallelujah. I do thank God for you. I thank God for our In-Season Ministries family and our Facebook friends and family for joining in and tuning in. I have a word for you tonight. I am Minister Cathy, and just bow your heads with me. I'm going to go ahead and get started. Hallelujah. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to come before your people again, God. Oh, God, I ask that you just use me as your vessel, as your instrument, God. None of me, all of you, speak through me. I'm your mouthpiece, God. Anoint me to deliver the word that you have given me in the name of Jesus. And I pray that you open the eyes and the ears of your people, that they will be receptive of your word. Lord, let wisdom flow. Let understanding and knowledge flow tonight. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Hallelujah. So I have a question for you. Have you ever had a project that you started but did not finish? Amen. Hallelujah. Whether it was building something, making something, fixing something, cleaning the garage, taking a course, going to school, you started, but you didn't finish. Hallelujah. I know, you know, I'm guilty so many times. And when I thought about this lesson and when I was going through it, I was just reminded of so many things. And as a teacher, I see a lot of unfinished work. And at the end of every 9 weeks, when grades are entered or need to be entered for report cards, I'll get an email reminding all the teachers that there can be no incomplete for a final grade. So the incomplete grades occur when the work has not been completed. So the student either has to complete that work, but if they haven't completed it by the deadline, then that I for incomplete becomes an F, because no incomplete can be assigned. Hallelujah. And that's the title of my message, No Incomplete. The word incomplete means not completed, unfinished, lacking some part, is half done, undone, or partial. Another definition is that it's a temporary grade indicating that a student has not fulfilled one or more of the essential requirements of a course, as I mentioned a moment ago. So as I saw in the audience, in the congregation, many of us have a lot of unfinished projects, a lot of things that we started and we did not finish. And when we look at ourselves, we can look at ourselves as unfinished products also. So we may not finish our product, but God, he always starts the project and he always completes it. He always finishes what he starts. And we are his product, we are his projects, and we are a work in progress. And because we're incomplete, it doesn't mean that God quit on us. It doesn't mean that God stopped doing his work. What I found is that we give up on God. And I also realized that a lot of the ideas, a lot of the thoughts, a lot of the dreams that we've had It was God inspired, but we didn't complete the work. As I was studying this, I was reminded that there are assignments, there are gifts, there are talents and skills and abilities, resources, creative ideas and witty inventions that God has given us. And if we would have completed the assignment, it could have changed the course and the trajectory of our lives. It could have changed, made a difference in our spiritual growth, in our church, in our ministry, in our finances, in our homes, and with our families, with our careers and businesses, even with our health and our mental well-being. But we didn't complete the assignment. We didn't do the work. So what I would like for you to do, just take a few seconds to reflect on something that God told you to do or an assignment that you had, whether you thought it was just an idea or a thought or a dream, but something that you did not complete. Just put something in your mind right now that you knew or you felt like you should have done it, but you didn't get it done. Because God gives us gifts. He gives us talents. He gives us skills and abilities. And it's not just from us, it's from God. So you may have thought that it was you, but God gave it to you to bring glory to his kingdom. But not only that, he has started a work in you, and he is able to complete it. You are his work in progress. So let's get to the Word of God. If you can, get your Bibles, follow along, take notes so you can reflect on this later. I will be reading from both the King James Version and the Living Bible. Go with me to Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. Philippians chapter 1, verse 6. And the King James Version reads, "Being confident of this very thing, that he which has begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ." The Living Bible reads, "And I am sure that God, who began the good work within you, will keep right on helping you grow in his grace until his task within you is finally finished on that day when Jesus Christ returns." So in this passage, the Apostle Paul was addressing the Philippians, and he was confident that the work that God was doing in their lives was taking place among the believers. And the word "until" lets us know that it was a progress toward a goal and a time that is coming that God will completely finish the work among the people. That work continues until Jesus returns. So God always does his part. He always does his work. But as I mentioned before, we sometimes stop doing our part. So my students, they have missing assignments because they just stopped working, or they, for some reason, they didn't do it. And what I find also is that some of them are present, but they're not really present. Sometimes I walk around the room and I find students just sitting there. And the funniest thing is sometimes I see them before I get up. So they will have their computer screen on the assignment, but they're sitting there doing nothing. Or when it's time for me to grade the assignments or post the grades, I realize that they didn't do the work. They were just sitting there, you know, faking it. And then I walk around sometimes, and every now and then I'll find a student that may be trying to sleep, and I have to wake them up. And what I realized is that, like those students with the incomplete assignments, many of us have stopped working. We are present, but we're not present. We're sitting in church, but we're not doing anything. we're sleeping on God. And as my grandmother would say, and I refer to her a lot, she would have it was a phrase that she would say. I'm not sure if it was a song, but I remember her saying this: don't let him catch you with your work undone, because there can be no incomplete. Go with me to Mark chapter 13, verses 34 through 37. Mark chapter 13, and we'll begin at verse 34. King James Version reads, "For the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, who left his house and gave authority to his servants, and to every man his work, and commanded the porter to watch." The Living Bible reads, "My coming can be compared with that of a man who went on a trip to another country. He laid out his employees' work for them to do while he was gone, and told the gatekeeper to watch for his return." Verse 35 reads from the King James Version, "Watch ye therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh, at even, or at midnight, or at the cock crowing, or in the morning. Least coming," verse 36, "least coming suddenly, he find you sleeping." Verse 37 reads, "And what I say unto you, I say unto all, watch." And I'm going to read those verses 35 through 37 from the Living Bible. It reads, "Keep a sharp lookout, for you do not know when I will come, at evening, at midnight, early dawn, or late break day. Don't let me find you sleeping. Watch for my return. This is my message to you and to everyone else." So, in other words, you don't know when Jesus will return. He doesn't want to find you sleeping. Don't sleep on God. Don't sit there and do nothing. Don't let him find you with your work undone. You need to watch for his return. And as my pastor always tells us, you need to be ready. So people don't do their assignments for a few reasons. Some of them, they just stop trying. Some of them, they procrastinate. Others get fearful, or they're intimidated by what they see or what they think. And some of them, they just get too comfortable. They're too complacent. And just like students, many saints have become too complacent. The word complacent means self-satisfied, especially when accompanied by unawareness of actual dangers or deficiencies. In other words, you're satisfied with yourself, but you don't even see the danger in it or the things that you lack, your own deficiencies. It also means that you're unconcerned, you're uninterested, you're content, you're just too comfortable. So let's see how God feels about being complacent. Go with me to Revelation chapter 3. And we're going to look at verses 15 and 16. Revelation chapter 3, verses 15 and 16. And the King James Version reads, "I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that wert cold or hot." The Living Bible reads, "I know you well. You are neither hot nor cold. I wish you were one or the other." You see, cold water can be refreshing. Hot water can actually kill germs. But what purpose does the lukewarm water serve other than feeling good and just being comfortable? Verse 16, So then, because thou art lukewarm, neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. The Living Bible says it this way. But since you are merely lukewarm, I will spit you out of my mouth. And why? Because you're not serving a purpose. The lukewarm person is just comfortable, taking up a place and taking up a space. And God, he's saying, I know what you do and I know what you don't do. I wish that you were either hot or cold, but he's saying that you're lukewarm. You have gotten too comfortable. You are complacent. And why God doesn't like this is because he rejects half-hearted efforts of self-satisfied saints. People that stop because they were just satisfied where they were. So don't stop because you're satisfied where you are. When you're complacent, there's no drive to grow. There's no drive to get better. There's no drive to become because you're satisfied, you're comfortable. You're at a standstill, and that's a problem with God. He wants you to be your best you, but that requires work, and it requires you to be present. No excuses and no incomplete. So if we look at our theme for our church this year, it says, let's go forward. And even President Biden has declared that he's going to move the country forward. And then we just played a song that says, I'm moving on. But you can't go forward at a standstill. You can't move forward just sitting there doing nothing. You must go, you must move, and you must do something. So you may be wondering, so how do I go forward? How do I go forward? I just told you, you got to move, you got to do something, you need to pursue, and you need to press. Because there can be no incomplete. Because Christ is going to judge when he returns. Hallelujah. So go with me to Philippians chapter 3. And we'll look at verses 12 through 14. Philippians chapter 3, verses 12 through 14. And I mentioned the word press, and that means to pursue with all deliberate speed. To pursue with all deliberate speed. So we need to move. We need to do something by pursuing and pressing. Philippians chapter 3, verse 12 from the King James Version reads, not as though I have already attained, neither were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. The Living Bible puts it this way. I don't mean to say I am perfect. I haven't learned all I should even yet. But I keep working towards that day when I will finally be all that Christ saved me for and wants me to be. This was the Apostle Paul speaking again. And again, he's speaking to the Philippians. And he actually wrote this letter while he was in prison. He started that church about 10 years before writing that letter. And he was telling them, he wanted them to know that God doesn't just start something great in us, but he is well able and capable of finishing what he starts. The word obtain that I read from the King James Version, it means to arrive, to become a partaker of, not yet gain possession of, or lay hold of, or grab. And the word perfect means mature, complete, or finished. So he tells them that he hasn't arrived, that he's not perfect, but he's working towards it, that he is a work in progress, and that he's working towards being all that Christ wants him to be. And that goes for us too. We should be a work in progress. We should be working towards all that God wants us to be. Verse 13 says, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before." The Living Bible says, "No, dear brothers, I am still not all I should be, for I am bringing all my energies to bear on this one thing, forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead." You see, Paul, people could have easily said, well, you know, he arrived because he wrote 13 of the New Testament books in the Bible. And that's a great accomplishment. His legacy is still living because we're still reading what he wrote, and we're still affected and benefiting from the work that he put in. But even with all of that, he's letting them know, I'm not there yet. God isn't finished with me yet. Even at that point in time, he's saying, I haven't arrived to my destination yet. There is more work to be done. And the word yet is a faith word, because it means that it's going to happen. You see, when you have a growth mindset, and we teach this in school, when you have a growth mindset, even if there's something that you haven't accomplished at that time, you just say yet. So you say, you know, I haven't learned it yet. Don't say I can't learn it, or, you know, I don't know it, or I can't do it. You put that yet on it because you're working towards it. And you know at some point in time, you're going to be able to do it. So yet is a faith word, and it means that it's going to happen. So Paul was going to use all his strength and all his energy to grab hold onto God. Hallelujah, because at once, when he had that encounter, God literally grabbed hold of him. And we know Paul's story. He was on his way, on the road to Damascus, and he had been persecuting the church, the saints of God, and he had an encounter with God that literally changed the course of his life. And he's saying, even with all of that, just how God grabbed hold of me, and that word attain, one of the definition for that is to grab hold of. He's saying, I'm going to grab hold of God. I'm going to use all my strength to do this, but I'm going to forget what's behind me. I'm going to look at what is ahead. And whenever you have the ing on a word, it means it's also a continual process. So it's ongoing. He said he's forgetting and he's looking. So he's constantly doing this. It's not just a one-day thing. You do it one day and then you stop, because we're a work in progress. And so we're constantly growing. We should constantly be growing. We should constantly be moving and working towards those things that God wants us to do. But he said he's not going to focus on the past. He's going to forget those things. And he's going to put his focus on what's ahead. He's going to put his focus on the future. And he uses the analogy of a runner. And when a runner looks back, three things can happen. It can slow that runner down. It can get that runner off course. And it can cause him to lose the race. So Paul is saying, I'm not going to put my attention what's behind me. You know, I may trip and fall again. So I'm not going to focus on those things behind me. And I don't want to get off course, because if I'm on a track and I have to stay in my lane, if I'm looking behind me, I can easily get off course and go in the wrong lane. Or I can easily just go and off into a detour, even in the course of life. So you want to keep your eyes focused on what's ahead. And then he definitely didn't want to lose the race. Because if you're looking back and you're running, it slows you down. And so you can lose the race. So he's saying, I'm not going to look back, but I'm going to move forward. And God wants us to do the same. He wants us to move forward, and he wants us to complete the assignments before us. No incomplete. So I say to you tonight, don't slow down. Don't get off course. Don't lose the race, because there can be no incomplete. Move forward to what is in front of you. Focus on your future. Focus on your purpose. Stay focused on God. Keep your eyes on Jesus. You see, your eyes are the windows to your soul. So you have to be careful what gets into your soul. The soul is the seat of your mind, your will, and your emotions. So you have to protect that, and you have to guard that, and you have to be careful of what goes into your soul. So keep your eyes on Jesus. Verse 14 says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. The Living Bible says, I strain to reach the end of the race and receive the prize for which God is calling us up to heaven because of what Christ Jesus did for us. He's saying, I press toward the goal. I'm going to pursue with deliberate speed towards that goal, because that goal refers to that marker at the end of the race, which a runner intentionally fixed their eyes on. They're going to look at that finish line. They're going to look at something higher, and that's what we should be doing. Pressing toward the mark of which God is calling us to do. That prize, that reward. So he's saying, I must press and I must condition myself to reach the end of the race, that day when Christ returns, to complete my assignments. I must put my mind, my body, and my soul under subjection. It requires a stretching. It requires a sacrifice. It requires training, just like you're in practice. If you play sports or if you coach, you understand that whatever you practice, you get better at. But it's a sacrifice, because sometimes you have to be on the field when nobody else is on the field. Sometimes you have to work out when nobody else is working out. So you have to pursue and you have to stretch yourselves. And so in doing so, we stretch our bodies, we stretch our minds, and we stretch our souls. And we have to run with all of our strength. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. And so we practice when we don't feel like practicing. And practice for us is reading the Word of God. So we're going to read that Bible even when we don't feel like reading it. We're going to pray when we don't feel like praying. Fast when you don't feel like fasting. Hallelujah. We have to worship when you don't feel like worshiping. Hallelujah. Because we bring him a sacrifice. And we need to obey, even if you don't want to obey, but you need to obey. Just do it, just like you obey your parents. Sometimes you didn't feel like doing it. You didn't want to do it. But out of the respect and the love that you have for them, you obeyed and you did what they asked you to do. And we have to do that same thing. And we have to keep in mind that when our leaders ask us to do something, they're in the place of God. They're standing in the place of God. So that's just like God telling you to do something. That's just like God. They're speaking on behalf of God. And so when you obey them, you're obeying God. And sometimes you have to serve when you don't feel like serving. You got to serve God's people. Whatever job he gives you to do, you need to do it. Whatever task he gives you to do, you need to do it. Because remember, some of the gifts and the talents and your skills and resources and your money, they come from God to bring glory to his kingdom. So we serve when we don't feel like serving. We complete the assignments even when you don't feel like doing the work. Yes. You know, a good student, even when they're tired, they're going to still do their work. They may not feel like it, but they get their work done. They don't just sit there because they understand that it takes sometimes a sacrifice, and they're working towards a grade, and they want a good grade. Yes. So they do the work regardless of the way they feel. Complete the assignment. Put your mind again, your body and your soul under subjection to the Spirit of God, because he is calling you up. There can be no incomplete. You have to be intentional about this, be consistent, and pursue with all deliberate speed. Let's go forward. Let's finish the work. No incomplete. Hallelujah. Please, let's give God a praise for his word. Hallelujah. I want to pray real quick. Thank you, God. Oh, Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for speaking to your people. Hallelujah. I pray that they have received your word. I pray, Lord, that you will anoint us to complete the assignments that you have given us. Help us to recognize that you have given us special talents, abilities, skills, the know-hows, the resources, the money. Hallelujah. You have given us those things, Lord. Hallelujah. To be a blessing to your kingdom, to finish the work that you've called us to do. Those thoughts, those ideas, those things, those dreams that we had that we didn't even know that it came from you, Lord, even when we thought it was just us thinking about such things, God. Help us to recognize, God, when you're talking to us. Help us to recognize what is God-inspired, Lord. Help us to hear your voice, God, in the name of Jesus. Oh, God, we're going to pursue. We're going to obey your voice, God, and we're going to do what you say. Hallelujah. Help us to finish the work, God, the assignments that you called us to do. Hallelujah. And I ask that you finish the work in us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Make us mature. Make us complete in you, God. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Let's give God a praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. And perhaps you heard this word and you don't know the Lord as your personal Savior. Hallelujah. I want to pray with you and lead you to Christ. Hallelujah. Perhaps you're thinking that, you know, you're recognizing that it was some things that came to your mind. Hallelujah. And you weren't sure. But now hearing the word of God, maybe the Lord has touched your heart and opened your ears and your eyes to see that it was him. Hallelujah. But I want to pray with you that you receive the Lord as your Savior first. Hallelujah. So that he can finish the work in you. He can't finish the work in you if you don't accept him, if you don't allow him to come in. Hallelujah. So I want to pray with you right now. Repeat after me. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I repent of my sins. I believe that you are the Son of God and that you died for me. Lord Jesus, save my soul. Set me free. Come, finish the work in me. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. You are now saved. It's just that simple. All you have to do is receive him. Hallelujah. Once you invite him in, just receive him and you are saved. Welcome to the family of God. I give God praise for you and I thank God for your soul. Hallelujah. So I want to encourage you to do two things. We at In Season Ministry, we encourage you to read and study your Bible. If you don't know where to begin, begin in the book of Proverbs and start with the chapter that corresponds with the day of the month. And that way you can get through the entire chapter and you can know from day to day where you left off. And then I want to encourage you to find a church, a Bible-believing church, one who preaches the truth, one who challenges you to live holy, one who is going to help you grow in Christ. Hallelujah. I thank you for joining in our time of worship. I'm Minister Cathy from In Season Ministry. We love you. We thank you. Be blessed.